was dreaming, counting the ways to where you are. I'm 22 for a moment, and she feels better than ever. And we're on fire, making our way back from Mars.
You remember that song, right? It's called 100 Years by Five for Fighting, and it was released back in 2003. I was literally a verse in that song. The part where he sings, "I'm 45 for a moment, the sea is high, and I'm heading into a crisis, chasing the years of my life." I'm David Aben, founder of The Bucket, and back then, I was already thinking of creating The Bucket, and I said to myself, if I ever do it, I want to talk to them about this song and how much it reinforces The Bucket's mission of being aware of and enjoying every moment of your life. Well, I did finally launch The Bucket, and true to my word, I reached out to Five for Fighting, which I learned is not so much a band as a man. And that man's name is John Ondrasik. I was thrilled when John's rep got back to me and said he would be happy to be on a podcast. 100 Years was not John's only hit. He had a number of songs work their way up the Billboard charts, and in fact, performed one of them, Superman, on stage at the Concert for New York City following 9/11. Alongside The Who, Elton John, Mick Jagger, Keith Richards, and Paul McCartney, among many others. Today, John is still writing and performing and still helps manage his family's business, Precision Wire Products. I've waited 15 years for this, but I am thrilled to finally be able to welcome John Ondrasik to the Bucket Podcast. Welcome, John. Thanks for talking with me today.
David, pleasure to talk to you.
So where are you today? When we first talked about doing this, you were in the middle of a tour. Are you still touring or are you back home?
I am now. Wearing my other hat, I'm at the Ondrasik Family Business, which is a company called Precision Wire Products that is in Commerce, California, that's been in our family since the 40s. And my dad's been running it the last 30 years. And I've spent my whole life, even through the heights and roller coasters of my music career, working down here. Our claim to fame is we make the best shopping cart in the world. And if you shop at Costco, you use our cart. You being in the Northeast, if you shop at BJ's, you may very likely use our cart. So I'm doing the other thing today. The music will be happening tonight when I get home and put that hat back on. But today I'm calling you from my office here in lovely Commerce, California.
That's great. Well, you've written a lot of great songs, you know, Superman, Easy Tonight, Chances, but the one I want to talk to you about is 100 Years. That's a song, for me, it resonated so much for me when I first heard it back when I was 45. So when that verse comes out, I'm 45 for a moment, the sea is high, and I'm heading into a crisis, chasing the years of my life, it was like it grabbed me by the throat. And And even the previous verse, like, I'm 33 for a moment, still the man, but you see I'm a they, a kid on the way. Well, that was me too. When I was 33, my daughter had just been born. But it just, like I said, the song grabbed me. And I'm sure that it's grabbed a lot of people. Tell me about your experience with people's reaction to the song.
You know, it's people talk a lot about Superman, and certainly Superman, we wouldn't be talking without Superman, and there'd be no 100 years without Superman. But, you know, people always ask, well, if you could pick one song, you know, 100 years is that song for me. You know, 100 years for a lot of reasons. One, you can grow up with it and through it, which I've done. You mentioned the 45 verse. You know, I was in my early 30s when I wrote 100 years, and kind of in that early family stage. And who knew how right I was? And as I hit that 45, 46, you know, that midlife crisis came crashing down, and I'm still kind of, you know, at the tail end of it, turned 55 last week. But, you know, I always look at my songs as kind of gifts. I kind of figure, even though I write them, when I put them out in the world, they don't become mine. And it's still really rewarding when you hear that song at graduations, weddings, funerals, anniversaries. It's kind of one of those songs that can stand the test of time and fit every moment. And I think the sentiment of the song is so universal, and I mean, it's kind of your website, right? It's kind of the bucket. It's what I struggled with, and what I think so many of us struggle with, and people that, you know, engage in your website recognize this innate problem we have as human beings, where, you know, we're so kind of either lost in the past and dwelling on the past, or we're consumed with the future, that we kind of live our lives everywhere but the present. You know, as an ambitious musician, I was always pushing the goalposts. Even when I had the number one song in the country, it was very hard for me to sit back and go, oh my God, I have the number one song in the country. I've worked my whole life for this, and isn't it amazing, and how wonderful. And, you know, I was more focusing on, all right, so how do we parlay this into the next one, and how do we move the goalposts, and how do we, you know. So it's very hard, I think, for us to recognize the moment. And I think with 100 years, so many people relate to it because we struggle with that. And it doesn't mean the moment's always good. Sometimes it's terrible, you know, but we have to recognize that too, and everything in between. And so I think that sentiment of 100 years, and the fact that whatever age you are, whatever stage of your life you are, you're in that song. You know, you're between 15 and 100. Most of us are in that song. So
yeah,
I think that's why it still resonates.
So I had read something, I forget where, about when you played it for your wife for the first time, mm-hmm. she broke down into tears. And was that the moment you knew that it had hit home, or did you already know?
Well, you never know. It's subjective, and it depends on timing and the zeitgeist of the country and what is happening in music. I think the reason, you know, when I tell that story about 100 years, you know, I'd come off Superman, right?
Which
was a big song, and it certainly had a meaning with the country after 9/11. And as a young songwriter, you know, it's your first hit, and forget just trying to follow that song. But when you have to follow a song that had that kind of width and meaning.
Right, because you played that at, I'm sorry, but you played that at the concert of New York after 9/11,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, I played at the concert for New York, and it found such a place within various charities. It's like, you can't follow that, but you also don't want to be a one-hit wonder. And the tendency, you know, for many young songwriters is to try to regurgitate your first hit. And my joke is, you know, we all saw Superman too, and that didn't work out too well. So how do you follow Superman as a young songwriter? Also, frankly, the repercussions for my career were huge. If you have one hit song, you're blessed, but it doesn't mean you have a career. There's a lot of songs we know that were one hit wonders, and that was it. And so I knew the pressure of following that up with a popular song. And I spent 2 years trying to write the follow up to Superman. I made a whole record. And in my gut, I knew I didn't have that song. But when I wrote 100 Years, I didn't know if it was going to be a hit or resonate, but I thought it had some of the components of a song that could be popular and touch people, and because it really was an issue I felt within myself. I knew, you know, a lot of these songs I say are post-it notes to myself. Superman was a post-it note to myself when I was younger and I was, you know, frustrated about not being heard. And 100 Years was a post-it note about, dude, look around. You're kind of, at least for this moment, you're living your childhood dream. You're making music. People are actually singing your song back to you. You do a show and someone buys a ticket. You have a wonderful wife who supports you. You have great parents. You got two young kids. It's like, recognize that. You know, it's not always going to be this way. And I was right. You know, it wasn't always that way. And as you grow and things change. So, you know, for me, when I wrote that, I had a sense that this has some of those intangibles and some of that kind of wit that Superman has. It also has the melody that I think is very catchy. It suits my voice, and it doesn't sound like Superman. It sounds like a song, if you never heard Superman, you heard 100 Years, you'd be like, wow, that might be somebody I'd listen to. And my wife was a music publisher. She signed me to my first publishing deal. She knew hit songs. She was instrumental in many careers of hit songwriters, from Jewel to No Doubt to Incubus, down the line. So that was her job. She knew hit songs. And she knew, I think, for our family, what it would mean to have another one that resonated. So when I first played her 100 years, you know, as I said, the joke is, you know, I looked at her in the doorway and tears were running down her face. And I thought to myself, well, either I wrote a hit or my career is over. You know, luckily it worked.
Yeah, it's funny. You mentioned all the places 100 years has played, whether it's publicly or privately, and you know, graduation things and the shows it's been on. It's been on commercials. It was on for Katie Couric's last day. And I don't know if you know this, but when the Red Sox won the World Series in 2004, they did a montage with 100 years. And some of the time I feel like the meaning has gotten hijacked, at least for me, where it's like, this isn't about 100 years, the actual time period. This is about time fleeting. And do you ever feel that way, or do you, it's like fine however anybody interprets it?
Well, I think most people get it. You know, what I've learned very quickly is the songs, even though you write them, they're really not yours. And they kind of shouldn't be. And the beautiful thing about music, I think that's a unique medium, is that people will take songs they like and apply them to their lives in a way they need them the most. And this was illustrated to me when Superman was out and popular, and I was corresponding with our troops overseas during the first Iraq War. And I would get emails from them, and they would tell me, you know, I listen to your song before I go on mission to focus. Or I listen to your song when I get back from mission to calm myself down. Or I listen to your song to escape. I listen to your song to remind myself of home. And it's the same song. And people use it in so many different ways. And I think with 100 years too, I think, you know, I'm never, you know, disappointed or missed if somebody's like, well, you didn't get my point of view. Because frankly, my point of view really doesn't matter to anyone but me. When I listen to Every Breath You Take, or I listen to a Joni Mitchell song, or a Leonard Cohen song, or a James Taylor song, it's what it matters to me. It's nice that they're popular and everybody can sing them. But I think for 100 years, just because you see the context, you know, yes, of course, do people use 100 years in many like life movies for grandpa or at funerals? Well, it is a life. And what are our lives made of? Our lives are made of moments. Hopefully many joyous ones, many triumphs, but of course many sad ones and challenging ones too, and everything in between. So our lives are made of moments. I just, for me, the song was like, try to recognize those moments as you're living them. Don't let them just be on some video when you're 92 years old and people are playing your life. And you're like, oh, that was pretty great.
Yeah.
You know, hopefully while it was great, you were sitting there going, this is pretty great.
Right. And you talked before about you're moving through your life, and as you move through your life, when you think about 100 years, has anything changed about how you feel when you wrote it till now? And one thing, I'm going to jump in and answer that question first, which is, I wish you hadn't put so much space between 67 and 99. Because it seems like you cut to the end there. It's like, that's a long period of time. And especially for our audience, in terms of going into that, a lot can happen in that space.
Well, I have two excuses. The first being, you know, when you're 33, you're probably not even imagining what things are like at 65. You can't even, you know, I have my daughter's, you know, turning 19, and she's thinking that the best years are behind her. She's like, I'm 19 and I haven't accomplished anything. I'm like, you're 19, you shouldn't, you know. I think the other practical reason is the song was already 4 minutes and 20 seconds long. And if it was any longer, the radio was never playing. So
right.
I had to cut it off at some point. So I really, you're right, I jumped from 67 to Wayne Gretzky really quickly, just to get to the point. But no, you're right. And you know, my dad's a perfect example of that. As I said, I'm down at the family business. My dad's 82 years old and he still runs the family business. He works 70 hours a week. He works out an hour and a half a day, going strong, vital, doing what he's done his whole life. And why is that? I think that's because he is doing something he loves and something that he's been doing. And you know, retirement to him is like, doesn't exist. You know, he's going to do this till he can't do it anymore. And, you know, you would hope, you know, my hope, it hasn't happened yet, but you hope that you work your whole life to get a point where you can make decisions about having the life you want that you probably couldn't do when you're 25 or 35 or 45, when you're trying to build security and you have a family and you got to, you know, support everybody and do whatever you got to do and emotional transitions. You would hope that this last third of your life is the best because you have more control over it and you're not obligated to do certain things. Of course, that's not the way it is for everybody, but I look at my dad and I see, you know, his last 20 years, you know, and they've been wonderful and they've been something I'd wish everybody would have. So I think you're right. And I think what you're doing with the bucket and focusing people on the bucket list and don't wait. And, you know, I'll end my speech in a minute, but I do think, you know, we have this tendency, no matter what age we are, and I've done this my whole life, it's like, well, I'll do this then. I'll do what I really want once I get through this job, once I get through this relationship, once I get, you know, with my whole music career, it was like, well, I'll write a musical, you know, later. And a lot of times when you have that attitude, that stuff never happens. And it takes effort to make a change, to do things. It takes effort to say, all right, I'm going to do something I've never done that I've always wanted to. My wife's big thing is she wants to see the Northern Lights, the Aurora Borealis. That's on her bucket list, and she wants to do that, and that's her dream. And we talk about it every year, and we still haven't done it. And, you know, but to do it takes effort. You got to book some plane tickets. You got to, like, hope the weather's right. You got to spend some money. And it's just easier to push that off. But so many things, I think, what makes life worth living and we've worked hard, we should be doing in that, you know, last third, last half of our life, because we've put the work in. Now let's go get the joy.
Yeah, it's funny that you mentioned that idea, because we have the title and idea for an article that we still haven't written called When I Will, how you talk yourself, yeah, how you talk yourself out of life. And so people listening, we haven't written that article yet. So if you want to take that title, When I Will, submit the article and we'd love to read it, because it's something that I think, like you said, everybody does it. And maybe it's just not important enough for you to do that, but I think a lot of people end up wishing they had done things that they didn't do.
Well, I really like your what you just said, how to talk yourself out of life. I think that sounds like a book. I think you should write that. because I think it's true, and it's so important, and we all do it. Because it's kind of easier to push it off. My wife is actually much better this than I am, you know, with her friends and her relationships and doing things, you know, life things and scheduling things for the family and experiences. I'm not very good at that because, you know, when you have a day-to-day job, there's always something you got to do that day. And kind of the music career, well, there's always a reason to write a song or always a reason to book a tour. Or always, you're always kind of pushing. And so many of us, especially of us who've kind of been ambitious and busy and worked our whole lives, that mindset is hard to change when it's something that's all you know how to do. Is you're always pushing, you're always, you know, grinding, you're always looking for the next thing. It's hard to, you know, it's kind of like a dysfunctional relationship with yourself. It's hard to change that mindset when you've been doing it your whole life. It took me 20 years to say no. And it sounds like a joke, but literally, as an up-and-coming musician, you know, I was so consumed with succeeding and fulfilling my passion and trying to make a living at this, I would do everything anybody asked. Any dog and pony show, any promotion event, no matter how embarrassing, early in my career, because of the name Fight for Fighting, many promoters thought I was a heavy metal band. And they would book me into these gigs with these heavy metal artists, and I'd show up with a nice little keyboard, and I'd be playing Superman, and people would be like moshing and like throwing things, and I'd be like, I'm taking that gig. You know why? Because if I don't take it, someone else might. Maybe that's the gig that somebody will see me. So for my whole life, you know, even when I was very successful, I couldn't say no, because that's all I, you know, that's what made me who I was. And to learn to say no, I'm not going to do that, I'm going to do something for me, can be hard to do. And I think, you know, to your point with what you're talking about on your website, it's understandable. And I think we need to realize that about ourselves. And once we realize that, maybe we can start making decisions to kind of get out of that mindset.
Yeah, you went through it at a younger age, but I think a lot of people, a lot of our readers are going through that in kind of like their second life with retirement, or they're in a situation and they may not have the issue of not being able to say no, but they don't know how to get out. And one of the things we're trying to do is publish articles that give examples of how people have done it. And you're a great example of that.
Well, and also I think people are different. You know, my dad's somebody that needs to be working every day. You know, other people are not. Other people are like, you know what? I've worked my whole life and now I want to golf every day. And that's what makes them happy. And they've earned that. And that's wonderful. There's no right answer. I think it's really looking to yourself, what's best for me? You know, what's best for me? What are my kind of resources? Still got to be wise. You know, you got to be frugal and you got to think about the realities of the world. But once you kind of get over that, what is best for me and those around me? And maybe it's just like, has nothing to do with experiences. Maybe it's relationships. Maybe it's like, okay, I have some time now to develop a relationship with friends. Or maybe I've always wanted to play the piano. You know, maybe I want to write a book. Maybe I want to do a triathlon. Maybe I want to sleep for a month. Maybe I want to watch, you know, 2 months of The Godfather, whatever it is. I think as long as we do it for ourselves and we're like, wow, you know, we're experiencing life in the moment and doing what we like for ourselves, I think that's what matters.
Yeah, so I have a few questions I ask all our guests. And the first one is about your bucket age. The bucket age is something we created. It is, you basically take your statistical life expectancy, subtract your current age, and that's your bucket age. So my statistical life expectancy is about 85. I'm 61, so my bucket age is 24. And that's about how many years I have left on this planet. And we think it's a good thing to do. So you really, you know, kind of pick your head up and say, wow, this is how much time I have left. And you'll make decisions based on that in terms of what do you want to get done. And so what's your bucket age?
Well, because I wasn't exactly sure for the calculation, I actually went on your website and I used your calculator. And I was, first of all, very relieved that it wasn't negative. So the good news is my bucket age is 26, which is basically almost a third of my expected lifetime. As I said, I just turned 55. So, I'm doing some crazy rounding here, but I'm going to call it another third of my life, because I should have much more downtime than I did in the first two thirds of my life to do things. So yeah, I'm 26. So no excuses on my front. I got plenty of time, you know, to do a lot of things, even a second career if I want one, or a third career.
Yeah.
So,
So what do you think of this perspective of in a way counting your years down instead of up?
I love it. I actually wrote a song years ago called The Man Who Lived Backwards.
Oh, really?
And who was born at 100. And I know this kind of idea has been used in movies. It's born at 100, but lives backwards till he's born. So I've always kind of had this kind of weird kind of fascination with mortality and aging and getting older and the things you learn and the challenges. But, you know, until you actually do it, you know, it's some of the things I figured are coming true. And then there's other things I never imagined that I'm struggling with. But yeah, I think it's good. I think what you're doing is fantastic. I think it's very healthy. We have a population that's going to continue to age older with the healthcare and people take care of themselves. So people are going to be living longer. And I think we're seeing, you know, my dad's not an anomaly. We see people who are working longer, which I think is great. And so I think this whole thought of, you know, retire at 55, 60, 62, 66, and that's it. I think it's the opposite. I think it's kind of just the beginning. And you see people getting married to their high school sweethearts in their 70s, you know,
yeah.
You know, all these kind of things that life goes on. And the last, you know, the last 30 of your life could be the best 30 of your life. So I think what you're doing is fantastic.
Well, thank you. Next question. Let's say hypothetically, something happened to you and tomorrow you're on your deathbed. Would you have any regrets other than, of course, that you were on your deathbed? would there be anything like, I wish I had done this or I wish I had done that? And it not stuff that, you know, would be impossible to do, but kind of what you were saying before about the Northern Lights, like what would be on your list of things like, damn, I wish I had done that?
Well, I've been trying to do a triathlon for 2 years, so my body keeps breaking down on me. But I think it probably wouldn't be. I mean, you think about things like, you know, I'd love to see my child get married, or I'd love to have a grandchild, and you know, all this stuff. When you have kids, you'd like to see kind of them experience. But I think for me, probably the one regret I have is that I didn't develop more friend relationships. Because I was so kind of consumed with my music and my career and work, and then you have a family and then you have kids, you know, all of that stuff took priority of me developing friendships. And I certainly have some friends, but I really envy like my wife and some other folks I know have these deep, long rooted friendships that you can really use, when things are bad or when your friends have issues and you have these tight knit relationships that I think really, really help your life and your life experience and your day to day. And so one thing I'm trying to focus on in this stage of my life is take some time and, you know, friendships take work and take time to develop. And so that would probably be my one regret that I didn't allow myself to spend more time developing some deeper rooted friendships.
Well, since you have about 26 years left, did you say that you have time to do that?
Yes, I do. Thanks to you.
So how has your perspective on songwriting changed as you've gotten older?
You know, I think because my songs are pretty personal, that they kind of track your life. And it's not unique to me. You know, if you listen to my early songs, you know, go way back to Message for Albert, which was kind of the first record I made, and songs before I even, you know, had a record deal, you know, they tend to be more self-centered, which is natural. And they tend to be a little more trivial, you know, about cars and girls and stuff like that. And even Superman is a more selfish song. You know, it's not easy to be me, right? So it's about me. And because that's, when you're young, it's about you. It's you're kind of your world, and you're finding yourself in the world, and you're having this experience, and you're not attached to other human beings besides maybe your parents or your siblings. But then you'll notice with me in the Two Lights record, kind of right when I had kids, the whole thing kind of flipped. You know, so many of the songs were about my kids, songs like The Riddle. So many songs took a larger world view, like the song, you know, the title track, Two Lights, were kind of about our troops. So you start looking at the world differently. It's not all about you. It's about maybe your children and the world they're going to grow up in. And you start looking at the world, you know, the song world, you know, what kind of world do you want? So the songs aren't necessarily, you know, it's not what kind of world do I want. It's what kind of world do you want? And find we. So the songs get a little more global. And then, you know, as you get older and older, then you get a little more cynical. you hope that that doesn't reflect itself in the songs. You know, you also, as you get older, for me, you get a little more critical of your songs. You know, when you're young, you just write songs, you write 200 songs, and you put them out there and you do with them. You know, when you get older, it's harder to write a song that you like. I think you get a little more frustrated, and that's part of songwriting. So for me, you know, maybe I have a little bit of a more critical eye to my own songs, but I still try to express myself at the stage I'm in, and haven't made a record in a while. You know, have been writing some songs, but I do think, you know, talk about bucket lists. You know, I think it's probably time to document this stage in my life through songwriting, and hopefully in the next couple of years I'll do that.
Yeah, one of the things, you've talked about the troops a couple of times, and, you know, in doing my homework for this podcast, you know, I knew a lot of your songs, but what I didn't know is how much time you donate and of you and your songs to the military.
Yeah, you know, as I mentioned, you know, when Superman came out, I started corresponding with a lot of our troops, and I don't have military in my family, but I have great appreciation for our soldiers and veterans. You know, as a songwriter, we make our living on freedom of speech, and that's not guaranteed. Even though it seems like it's guaranteed, it's not. And I've been able to travel to places where, you know, there's consequences for freedom of speech. And, you know, I've been to Cuba, and I sat there and sang a song on the Cuban shores down in Gitmo. And so when you do that, you realize that, you know, here in the West, we're blessed. And sometimes we take our freedom for granted. And at the end of the day, who protects that and who secures that and who has given it to us? It's our soldiers. And so I've always felt a great debt to them and felt, you know, as a songwriter, I can't drive a tank or fly a plane, but I can write a song that maybe could help their morale or talk about their sacrifice. And so I've tried to do that, you know, written 5 or 6 songs, Two Lights, Freedom Never Cries, Note the Note Soldier, that have kind of spoke to their reality. You know, last year, me and Jim Brickman put out a Christmas song for the troops called Christmas Where You Are. I'm actually developing a Hallmark Channel movie based on that song that has a military component. And me and Gary Sinise go out and do shows and say thank you the best we can. So, you know, I think that one of the true blessings of having this career is that you can say thank you by lending your song or doing a show or going around the world and playing concerts. And for me, that's been a true highlight, just to do that. And for our troops, it's always an honor. And hopefully that's something I'll continue to do for the next 26 years of my life.
That's great. That's good. It's really impressive what you've done.
Thank you.
I did want to just circle back and talk to you a little bit more about your songs. So this theme of fleeting time seems to show up in a few other of your songs. I found Riddle to be about that. You know, the lyrics being about a man who starts off with his heart ran out of summers, so I assume that means he died. Who was that man? Was that a real person?
Well, you know, in the song, this singer's talking about is, you know, is he just lost his father. And a lot of people ask me, did you lose your father? Luckily, I did not. But as a songwriter, I take artistic license and try to write songs that have a meaning. And to me, the riddle, like so many of us, it's the search for meaning. Why are we here? All those questions. What are we doing? What's the purpose of it all? And many people spend their whole lives trying to figure that out or find an answer. And whether it's religion, spirituality, we all kind of look for that. And it was written around the time my kids were young. And sometimes you find meaning in your children's faces. You know, people I've heard, you know, the face of God is in a child's face. And you know, for me, kind of struggling with these things about recognizing the moment and purpose and all that stuff, you know, I kind of found at least part of my answer in kind of the innocence of youth of my children and whatever's going on in the world, whatever hardships or whatever challenges, you know, you look at your child's face and it all kind of just evaporates. And so maybe that's our purpose is that. Is it just love? Is it companionship? Is it, you know, sharing ourselves with another human being? And as I said, many people have different answers, but for me, that kind of venture was the purpose of the riddle. And probably, ironically, but probably appropriately, that was the hardest song of mine that are popular songs to write. Hmm. That song took the longest. It took me a year. And it's one of the songs where I still don't feel like totally got it right, probably because it's not answerable.
Right, it's, right.
It's a struggle. It's a confusion that we struggle with our whole lives.
Damn, John,
fate,
you didn't,
whatever you want to call it.
You didn't figure out the riddle of life. Jeez, you failed.
Hey, I still got 26 years.
That's true. So what's next for you? What are you doing now?
You know, who knows? I think certainly I'm spending a lot of time outside of music, kind of working with my dad here in California with the business. As I said, he's in his 80s and spending more time here and facing some of the challenges that California brings to any business and helping with that and with our employees. And my son's working here, which is great, spending time with him. And, you know, musically, I'm still doing my thing. You know, we just booked a short Southern California tour with String Quartet at the end of May. I'm doing more and more keynotes. I do a lot of keynotes that kind of combine my songs with talking about life, some of the stuff we've talked about today. Some of it's more business oriented, some of it's more philanthropy oriented, some of it's more motivational. So
yeah,
I
did see one of your TEDx talks, and it was great.
Yeah, thank you. So doing that, and then, you know, developing some projects, writing songs, you know, enjoying my children. My daughter's off to college, you know, so she's home for a month, so we're enjoying her and just, you know, kind of living life and trying to figure out, you know, what moments of joy. I told my wife this year on New Year's, she asked, what do you want to do this year? I go, I want to have more fun. So my goal this year is to kind of take up your message and live fully for this year and have great experiences and enjoy my family and enjoy my music and all the blessings that life has brought. And one day I'll send you that picture of the Northern Lights and maybe I'll write a little article for the Bucket.
How about a song too?
Hey man,
I'm gonna
never know.
Might as well ask.
26 years for a moment.
All right. I guess I'll ask if you have any questions for me.
No, I think that's good. As I said, I really kind of enjoyed your mission here. And when Julie sent me the note, went on your website, and as I said, it really reflects, I think, 100 years. And I'm glad you picked up on that song. And, you know, keep in touch. And as I said, I'll keep looking at your work and, you know, maybe write that book, you know,
because yeah.
I think so much of a song is the title, so you got the title.
Yeah, this is something that, believe it or not, I've been thinking about for over 30 years. When 100 years came out, I was already thinking about the Bucket, and that's why, you know, when I finally did it, and I said, I have to talk to you. That was like a drive for me because it meant so much to me, and it really made me say I've got to do the Bucket even that long ago that, you know, this idea of time, enjoying time while you have it is just, we, like you said before, we tend not to do that. And the biggest challenge we have is the taboo of death and mortality. People just run.
Yeah.
They run the other way. We presented to a sponsor, and they said, they asked us about the tagline, live fully, die well. And they said, were you concerned about the die well part? And I said, well, we talked a lot about it, but we feel that the die well is the edge. The die well is what will get it talked about. And they totally agreed. You need that edge. Otherwise, we're a lifestyle magazine.
Exactly. I mean, you're right. I mean, I looked at it too, and it made me a little uncomfortable, which it should, because they want to think about dying. But as you said, live fully is basically everybody's motto on everything. So that just makes you kind of generic and part of the pack. But the die well thing, that's frankly why I did this call with you, because, you know, that's interesting to me, and it makes me a little uncomfortable, but because it makes me uncomfortable, it may change my behavior.
Exactly.
Which is the whole purpose of this whole thing.
Well, I really appreciate your time, and I look forward to following up with you.
Yeah, my pleasure. Take care.
All right, you too. Bye-bye. Well, that was better than I even imagined. What a great guy. And I hope that the next time I talk to John, he is having more fun. And I hope you will be as well. Thanks for listening. To learn more about how to get the most out of your life by embracing your own mortality, go to thebucket.com. That's thebucket, all one word, .com.
And if you know someone you think should be on a future Bucket podcast, let us know at bucketfeedback@thebucket.com.
To live, have time going.